Grounded in faith, guided by grace, and going in love. And we want you to be a part of that. I have a few things before we have Pastor Bob come up. He's going to make some announcements this morning. I wanted to do a quick recap of yesterday. What a great day yesterday. We had a men's ministry, our Band of Brothers men's ministry event, bacon and Bible. And again, boy, the guys step it up. We had bacon wrapped venison backstrap. We had bacon wrapped pork loin. We had bacon wrapped cheese sticks, bacon pizza. If you can put bacon on it, even if you shouldn't put bacon on it, we had it. It was wonderful. And we had Clint Pleasant, coach of Rochester College, here to talk to us, March Madness theme. Had a really good day with the men. Thank you, men, who got involved and showed up yesterday. And then the women, right after, right on the tail, we barely got it cleaned up. I'm sure it still smelled like bacon, Cheryl. Did you smell the bacon essence? But we had it all cleaned up. The women came in, and they had a wonderful night last night as well. Good turnout. I heard it was a great time. Good connection. I heard women, there was a spirit of connectivity. People were getting to know one another. We love that. So we're thankful about that. Our men meet on Monday morning. We have a men's Monday morning group that Pastor Bob, Stan Hack are kind of lead that group. And they went, before our men's ministry event, they went out to the House of Providence property. Remember House of Providence? Jay and Maggie Dunn, I had them here, and we helped the girls, the foster care girls over Christmas. We're supporting them. We want them, we encourage them as they move from Detroit over to Oxford. And found out yesterday, John Mitchell called me. I saw you come in, John. Usually over here. Where you at, John? Did you sit somewhere else? You can't do that. You throw the preacher right up. John called me yesterday while I was here with the men, and he's like, man, I'm sorry I couldn't come, Pastor, but I'm just talking to somebody, and she's telling people about this group coming into Oxford, and they need support. There's people complaining about them, trying to get them shut down, and they need people to support them. It was called House of Providence. And he's like, Pastor, they're signing these forms, and if you live in Oxford, you can sign this form saying you're for it. Sometimes you just got to tell people you're positive about something. The negative people always show up. And so John said, hey, can I bring some of those? And he did. And so we'll make sure out on the counter today, we've got several of these copies. You need to be a resident of Oxford, correct? So Hortonville people, we're out. We'll help you sign it. We'll sign with you or something, but we can't sign on the dotted line. So if you live in Oxford, we encourage you to just take a second, look at this letter, fill it out, sign it, so we can make sure that House of Providence has some positive spin out there. That's an important thing. And for the life of me, there's something else. Garage sale. Well, let me know if I forget. Pastor Bob, make your way up here right now, wherever you're at. And while he's doing that, we want to make sure that you're aware that we're having that sale. I hate calling it a garage sale. I hate calling it a rummage sale. I don't know what we call it, but it's stuff. Everybody say stuff.
Stuff.
Say stuff better than that. One, two, three.
Stuff.
Stuff. We want to purge a little bit, get rid of all the stuff that we don't need, don't use, and just excess. We want to bring it together for God's good, God's glory. And so we're having that sale in May, and we're asking you to start collecting now, start organizing now, cleaning up the stuff so that we can get it here and it looks good, and we can sell that and put that money toward ministries that we support. And so today, Marie told me that they're having a meeting. Those of you involved and want to help with this project, the sale of stuff, it's going to be a meeting today right after church in the library. Meet with Marie and keep working on that and keep letting us know as a church so we're prepared. Pastor Bob, you got a microphone there. Tell us about two things you got coming up for us.
Yes, my birthday. Tiger colored. Home plate, it's been advertised for the last 5 or 6 weeks. We have two more weeks to get you signed up. I think we have like 70 going so far. I've ordered 100 tickets. Last year we had 115 go. But home plate is Saturday, April 29th, $34 a ticket. We have some special speakers. It's a whole program. It starts at 9:30 in the morning and it goes all day long. Rookie of the Year, Michael Fulmer, is going to be one of the speakers. James McCann, our catcher, I don't know. Anyway, he's another one. He is really great to listen to. Anyway, it's a special program. Then there's a time when you go out in the field and take pictures with some of the Tigers and stuff. So that goes on, and then we have the ball game. And we also have a special, anybody who wants to ride on a luxury bus. You what?
Who's driving
the bus?
Who's driving?
Not me. That would be Jeff Moore. Jeff or Kate, one of the other will drive it, because we won't let Pastor Don drive it either.
Thank you.
The guys rode with him one time, and that's something else. For the bus, rather than drive yourself and pay $25 or $30 to park, it's $5 a person or $10 a family. And make sure it's just family, don't be cheating. So anyway, that's home plate. If you have any questions, I'll be out there on at the counter in the lobby. The other thing is golfers. I'm pretty excited. Oh, thank you. That's what. I couldn't find my really nice one with the flag sticking up there. Couldn't find that any place. I think somebody liked it. Last year we had 32 regular golfers and 6 subs. It's for men and women. It's 2 subs. We play best ball format, which is kind of cool because Janella and I, we won 2 subs and she hits, we use her drive, but she hits them one else. Anyway, so it can be met. 2 men, 2 women, a man and a woman, a father, son, you know, mother, daughter, whatever you want to do. But let me see, 18 years of age up to 98. they're saying that would be me, I know it is. It starts May 17th, a week after one is over, with a get acquainted round, and then the league starts next week. Any questions on either one of these things? As I say, I'll be out there glad to answer most questions. I don't know all the answers. Whatever I don't know, I'll lie.
Thank you, Pastor Bob. Let's give him a round of applause. Sometimes they handle a mic, but you know, and he has fun with it. Yeah. I'm pretty sure Janella put that other hat in the rummage sale.
Yes. Sell it.
Oh, sorry. That's cool. Surprise. Good morning, everybody. We're so glad you're here to worship with us. My name is Pastor Shane. We're excited that you're here this morning. A couple other things I just want to highlight really quickly. One, we're getting ready. If you're new here at Oakwood, might wonder what we're doing here on Sunday mornings. We're going through something called the Gospel Project, and we're teaching through the Bible thematically and systematically from the beginning to the end. We can't hit every single verse, but we're kind of taking a big overview and zooming in on some of the big key passages throughout Scripture. We're using something called the Gospel Project to help us do that. And along with that, our children's ministries and our adult small groups, most of them, are kind of studying along with that, so that as people are studying at home or the kids are learning downstairs on Sunday morning, families can go home in the afternoon or throughout the week and talk about some of the same themes and Bible passages together. So it's a great thing, exciting thing. We're getting ready to start the third session of the Gospel Project. That'll start on April 2nd. So if you're new to Oakwood and haven't been around, we just want to make sure we're emphasizing that that's getting ready to start again. We're going to be heading into one called the Promised Land. So it'll be 12 weeks in there, plus a week for Easter. And so it's a great time if you're interested in getting plugged into a small group to connect and grow. Coming up here at the beginning of April is a great time to do that. We'll have about 12 weeks. That'll take us through the end of June. We'll take a couple of months off for the Gospel Project in the summer, and PD will be able to teach on some other things. Our children's ministries do things a little differently during the summer, too. So that's coming up. If you're interested in being in a small group or getting connected for that, there's some sign-up sheets on the counter out there in the cafe, so you can sign up. Just put some dates that you're available, and we'll work hard over the next couple weeks to make sure there's a spot for you to get plugged in and engage there as well. So that's coming up. You can always talk to me or the staff if you have questions about that or wanting to get connected as well. As we get ready to worship and pray this morning, I just want to give you one quick update. I've got David and Dana House. Hopefully you guys are praying for them. You guys wave so we can see you. David and Dana House are longtime members of Oakwood. They've been here for a little bit longer than I have, the last 6 years or so. And God's put a call on their heart to serve as missionaries. And so we've been praying for them, supporting them this past week. They were in Florida with Pioneers doing something called Explore. And it was kind of that next step where Pioneers was getting to know them on a deeper level, and they were kind of checking out Pioneers, making sure that maybe this is going to be a place that they could partner with as they seek God's call as missionaries. And they were excited to receive an offer of a position with Pioneers, and they accepted that this week. And so that doesn't mean they're off next week. That's just the start of the next step. And so it's kind of confirming who they're going to be partnering with So there's still a lot of details and a lot of timelines to work out. But I encourage you guys to continue to pray for David and Dana. We're going to try to get them up here in the next few weeks and give you guys a little more of an update. Because as we work with missionaries, especially someone from our own family that's going to be sent out, we want to have a great relationship. We'll be praying for them, encouraging them, and supporting them. So let's pray for them. Let's pray to prepare our hearts for what God has us this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Thanks for your family here at Oakwood. Thank you that as we are trying to build that family that's deep in our faith, and that's guided by grace, and then that's going in love, that you're putting on people's hearts like David and Dana to go out and to serve you in this community and around the world. And we just continue to pray your guidance and providence and blessing on them. Lord, give them rest. I know they had a draining week, but an exciting week. So continue to help them to process, give them clarity and discernment from your Spirit, Lord, as they seek next steps and directions for you and where you're sending them. And help us as a church family to just rally around them, support them in any way that we can, and bless them. We look forward to the fruit that's going to come from their service and labor wherever you send them. As we gather here this morning, Lord, we just want you to be glorified. We want our hearts to be open. We're excited. We know you're in this place. And we thank you that we have the privilege of being called your children and worshiping you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before we continue with our musical worship this morning, I just want to give a special thank you to this man right here, Michael. This is the last week he's going to be playing with me as a leader here on the team. And I just wanted to personally thank him and thank him from the team for his time here at Oakwood. He's going to be moving. And if you know him personally, you would know that he is honest all the time. But he's an awesome encourager, which makes his encouragement so much more genuine, knowing that it comes from an honest place in his heart. So I just wanted to thank him.
Thank you.
saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. It's one of my favorite things to think about, is the Lord rejoicing over me with singing. Just want to repay that favor this morning.
Amen.
powerful. Nothing's going to stop him. And the Lamb who laid himself down freely for our sacrifice. So we're going to collect the offering right now. Go ahead and have a seat if you would. Ask the ushers to come forward. Now let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. We thank you that we serve the sovereign Lord and that you're in control of everything. You're all powerful. And we know that we can trust ourselves fully to you. And we know that especially because you gave yourself for us, Lord, freely, generously. You've lavished your grace and forgiveness upon us, and we thank you for your love. And as we come now to give to you, Lord, we want to give generously. We want to give showing you that we believe in you, we trust in you, we love you, we're so grateful. Take these offerings and bless them for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
tell us that the wages of our sin is death. But because of you, Jesus, we are forgiven. And our debts are paid. Because of your love, because of your blood, we are clean and we are forgiven. And we just thank you for that this morning, Lord God.
Speak to you about that even today. Before we get into the message, we took time out of today For me to be able to sit down on the stool, but you know what that means. It's time for a fireside chat where the pastor gets to just talk to you. And so many things. There's so many things to talk about, but I chose just one. We're not going to talk about it. I wish I could. We're not going to talk about how great the giving was last week. That was fantastic. I would like to bring that up, but I don't have time. We're excited around here, folks. You need to know. I just want to make sure we get this straight. This church is an incredible giving church, and I've never thought that we had a problem or we have some kind of a disaster. Just to set it in simple terms, we looked at the growth of this church, and again, I was told on my way in this morning there's no parking spaces left. We are absolutely out of parking spaces this morning. We have pretty much full in the auditorium. Bragging about us, God is doing something here at Oakwood. Because of that, a year ago, we passed a really aggressive budget. I mean, we project, budgets are nothing but educated guesses about where you're going to be. And we made a guess based on how many people were coming and the growth, and we made a stretched budget where we wanted to do more things. We've got things we want to do here at Oakwood, and we guessed wrong. Not your fault. But we projected how many people are coming, what the giving should be, and we just overestimated what the giving would be. But your giving has stayed on track with last year. It really has. There's not been really a change in the amount of money you've been giving. The thing is, we as a church are more accustomed, for me as a pastor, to get up and say, we have a desperate need, give money because our furnace is going out. And people give toward that. They're like, I don't want to be cold, so let's give money. Well, we included that in the budget, and then nobody gets excited about that. So we're going to work hard at communicating with you more, but we did make cuts. You need to know we've scaled back. We've asked all our ministries to scale back a little bit, not spend money that they don't need to spend before the end of the year. We think we're going to be able to save a lot of money and get closer to being even on our budget. We've got some ideas how we can finish the year even on our budget and then go into the new year a little bit more, our new financial year, a little more wise, not trying to expand so much. But we're making those changes. But you just needed to know over the last couple weeks your giving has been extraordinarily good, and that makes it get closer to catching up. And so just wanted to thank you, love on you guys, and please never feel beat up. We as leadership understand you're a gracious giving church. But I don't have time to say any of that today. So what we're gonna talk about is SOS. I wanted to share my heart with you about what's coming up next weekend. Make sure you have a full picture of what we're trying to do. We're trying to we came up with lots of words. Halt hunger, help hunger. Help hunger sounds like you're making it worse. I don't know if that's the great way to say it. But we just came up with Hunger Day. And our SOS is all focused on this theme of hunger. Now, you and I might not feel that. I had lots of options this morning. I got up and made pancakes for my family with peanut butter or Nutella or syrup. You had your choice. Bacon on the side, of course. And I'm not hungry. I'm not physically hungry right now. I will be again. But when I get hungry again, there will be food. Yesterday at our men's thing, Clint talked about hunger. Hunger. Well, it's a good thing to talk about because the Lord says those who are hungry can partake of Him and they'll never be hungry again. But our problem is we are blessed. And when you're blessed, you might not ever experience hunger. But hunger is a problem. I'm not talking about Uganda, where my daughter sits this morning. I don't know what she's doing, but she's in Uganda somewhere, and she's going to come home, and I'm sure she's going to try to change everything we do at home. I'm sure we're going to be recycling and whatever. I don't know what it is. But she's going to come home and say, we've got to change, because she's experiencing it firsthand. We don't experience it firsthand. But it doesn't mean it's not happening right here. Hunger is happening right here. There are kids that if they don't get to eat at school, they just don't get to eat. Shrek, who goes out on the Stand Strength team, and we support them. He talks about the hunger needs in the mountains of Kentucky. He talks about these kids that they bring food to them because they're hungry. Principals, superintendents are saying kids simply can't learn because they're showing up and they haven't eaten. They had lunch at school yesterday. They show up the next day, next morning, and they haven't eaten dinner or breakfast. There's a need here. And you might not experience it, but that doesn't mean we don't need to step up and do something about it. So I really want to put a call out. I want us all to be involved next weekend in several ways. We're working with several ministries, Gleaners, Fish, Tribute to the Lord, Crossroads for Youth, and Stamp Out Hunger. Our U.S. Post Office does something every year. We're working with all these next Saturday to help hunger, to make a difference. Just that even if we don't experience it, we want to say we care and we want to make a difference. We need you to sign up and get involved. And no matter how many sign up, there are a few places that need help, like Gleaners and Fish. We need a few more to sign up to go there that day. Tribute to the Lord can need some more people. Crossroads for Youth, we're serving lunch to those youth out there. They might need some more people. But we can use 100 or 150 people to show up just for the Stamp on Hunger. The U.S. Postal Service every year sends out little bags in the mail, and they ask people to fill those bags with food, and they collect tonnage of food. It's a very effective way that our government says we're reaching every home. We can get every home to get involved with giving. Well, that comes with a lot of work. Those bags need to all be folded so a postcard can be stapled to them so they can put them in every mailbox in Oxford, Ordonville, Lake Orion, Pier. There's hundreds of thousands of bags that need to be folded. Well, we've got like 70,000 here that need to be folded by you. And that means I need hundreds of people next weekend to get involved. We probably won't finish it on Saturday. Probably going to be asking next Sunday for people to stay and fold bags after church next Sunday. But we need you to come and help, to get involved. Anybody can do it. Little kids to the oldest of our loved people here. Anybody can stay and at least fold bags. So we need you to sign up. Let us know you're coming next week. I'll be here at the church next Saturday morning leading that crew, folding those bags. We want to make sure every other team has enough to get out to their locations and serve. So what do you need to know? Well, this is our SOS team shirt. We started this ministry over a year ago. Actually, our first event was in April, I believe. So we've been doing a lot in 1 year. We asked you to get one of these shirts. And we show up wearing these shirts together because Oakwood is a family. We're a team. And we show up united. These shirts is a gift of $10. You can pick one up. They're at the table today. We want you to wear the shirt so we can be a team serving together. The next thing I want to encourage you to do is bring food. Why wait? We're going to be talking about hunger next weekend. Between now and next Sunday, bring some non-perishable food items. Drop them off at the church. Anything here by Saturday is going to go home with Fish. And they're going to take it and they're going to use it. So let's bring food. Go through your cupboards. Find some food that you, non-perishable foods that you can donate. And let's give. I wanted to go even further than that. And this one's a little touchy and sensitive. And I need you to understand, if you cannot do this, we're not disparaging you. But for those of us who can, I'm throwing out the challenge. From next Saturday noon to next Sunday noon, let's fast together. Let's choose to not eat for one whole day. Now, again, fasting is not meant to be promoted and shown. And we're not going to ask you to sign up for fasting. That would be wrong. We're not going to ask you to say, I'll fast and raise your hand. That would be wrong. This is a private thing you do. You go without for a period of time. And I'm asking you to go without food for 24 hours so that next Sunday we do feel hunger. I'm going to do that. It's going to be difficult because I have a family wedding Saturday night. They're probably going to have good food. But I'm going to choose not to, because I want to just hold back and give that to the Lord and pray and think about those who are hungry and don't have a choice. So I ask you to join me in that. If you've got a medical reason you cannot fast, I totally understand that. Maybe you could give up something other than food if you want to join us. But for those of you who can, let's be serious next weekend about serving and then fasting so we actually participate in the need. And let's make a difference. Let's make a difference. And I know we can. And I thank you for your kindness here at this church and how we get involved. But I really challenge you to step up and let's make a difference on Saturday. Sign up today, folks. Be a part of that. Let's pray this morning. I'd ask you to pray this prayer. You don't have to say anything out loud, but if you say, God, if there's anything you want me to hear this morning, I'm willing to listen. Can you give that prayer to God? God, if there's anything you want me to hear this morning, I'm willing to listen. God, I pray that you would be glorified, that everybody here would be edified, and that Satan would be horrified. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week we finished talking about the temple. And remember, I gave you the illustration about Grandma's house. The Old Testament is awkward to us, isn't it? And why do we spend so much time in the Old Testament? Well, we're going through the Bible chronologically, and it's going to take some time. If you're new to the church today, the reason why we're in the Old Testament is because we started at Genesis 1:1, and we're going chronologically all the way through Scriptures. And we're parked in deep stuff for the next couple of months. We're going to be talking about Leviticus, the law. We're going to be talking about all the rituals and things that God set up so that man could be in a relationship with the holy God. And all the time we're talking about that, I hope you know we're pointing you to Jesus, because the Old Testament points us back to, or points us forward to the cross. And then everything beyond the cross points us back to the cross. It's all about the cross. Everybody say the cross. It's about grace. It's about what Jesus did for us. But to fully understand it, we go back to see originally how God set it up for man to have a relationship with him, a way for us to come to him. So we're on God, the lawgiver. The big idea today, we should see delight. Everybody say delight.
Delight.
Not drudgery in Leviticus. We should see delight. I know it looks like drudgery. It looks like law upon law upon law. You might look at it and say, this is ridiculous. There's nothing like this. Law upon law upon law. Come on, people. Have you seen the tax code? If you saw the United States tax code for 2017, you'd think Leviticus is a piece of cake. This is not unheard of. When you look at Scripture, the people wanted detail. The people wanted to know how to get it right. And God gave them a way. It seems so odd and foreign to us. That's why I called it Grandma's house last week. My grandma, no electricity, no running water, an outhouse. Crazy stuff. So different. So when we go to the Old Testament, it might seem like that. I brought another illustration today. This thing. How many of you ever, we're going to show the difference to this morning. How many of you ever typed on one of these in school? Oh, look at it. So they got a good portion of you. Awesome. As I was reading this week and preparing this message, a pastor I was reading used the illustration about the old typewriter. And it clicked with me. The law, the Old Testament, Leviticus, to us is like this old typewriter. It kind of looks a little bit like what we use today, but it's so different. I know some of the young people are looking at it going, what's that gear shifter thing on the side? Got this big, and this one, I really appreciate somebody finding this for me. It was really hard to find a typewriter. Nobody has them anymore. But remember, this one doesn't have it, but the ones I love used to go, ding, love that. And I love the ding, and you knew how to shift it and return it. The carriage had to be returned. And so, the typewriter. Manual. Teens are like, how's he doing that? It's not plugged in. It must be wireless. It is. It's wireless. Wireless technology, folks. Wireless. Pastor Bob used to make every bulletin on these. Pastor Bob still tries to, he would love to have one of these to fill out marriage certificates, wouldn't you, Pastor Bob? He likes to type it, make it look good. You know, but I want to point out there's some similarities here between the old and the new. Matter of fact, there's some things that I've learned that I never really realized before. On your keyboards. Even on your little iPhones right now, if you brought up the keyboard, there's going to be a button called Shift. What does the Shift button do? Gets a capital letter. Do you know why it's called Shift? Because when you push the Shift button, when you push the Shift button, the whole thing had to shift in order for the capital letters to come up. We still use the same terms, even though there's no shifting that needs to take place. The shift button meant that you shifted from the lowercase to the other hammers that came up and hit the paper that were uppercase. It had to shift. We still call it shift. How many of you on your phones have a return key? Return key. You know what? They've tried to get better. Now they call it enter. Because return means to return this carriage back to the front. We return it so you can type the next line. You return it so you can keep typing. And we still have return buttons. See, what we have today goes back to this. And we still use the terminology that we had. But here's the best thing I love about this old typewriter. I remember I was talking to Tracy this morning about it. And Tracy's like, I used to use one of those. I'm like, really? I mean, she's way too young. I used one of these. I had typing class in my school. And I remember we would type. They would give us the sheet of paper, and I could not look at the paper and type. I had to look at my fingers to type. And we were competitive. It was trying to get your words a minute. Wham. You had to get your wham up. I was trying to get like 90 words a minute. Some people that are good typers are like, that's really bad. Well, for me, that would have been really good. 90 words a minute. And I remember what I would do is I would read it really quick, memorize it, and then type. And I was pretty good. My words a minute got really high, and my errors were really low. But my teacher saw me memorizing and then typing. And I'll never forget the day. It was the final exam. And the teacher said, okay, we're going to start the final exam. Here's what you're typing. You've got 1 minute. And get ready, get set. Oh, wait. Then she came over. I was ready to get home keys. You know what those are? The home keys, ready to go. And she taped a piece of paper here that draped over my fingers. And she said, by the way, you know you can't be looking at the keys. My words a minute fell off the chart. My errors became abundant. I couldn't see my hand. It was cruel, cruel. But Tracy brought up something about these old typewriters that some of you experienced. Remember when you made an error? Remember when you made a mistake? Back in this day, there was not a correction key. The young kids, backspace. There wasn't a correction key. You were stamping a hammer onto paper and making a mark. And if you made the wrong letter, you know what you had to do? You got some correction paper. Remember the white correction paper? You went back, put the correction paper on top of the mistake, and you hit the same key. What did you do? You covered over your mistake. That's atonement. Remember what atonement means? A covering. Today we just backspace and spell correct. Don't you love spell correct? It ruins my life. But we used to have to manually atone for our mistakes on the typewriter. Today I'm hoping you understand the Old Testament shouldn't be a drudgery to us. We should realize that God delights in his people, both then and now. The delight is in us, and he wants us to delight in him. And so while this technology might seem antiquated, and as you open up Leviticus, you might say, wow, this is old school, you still need to see what it's there for and what the purpose is. So this morning, I hope we find delight, not drudgery, in this word. It's so different. Church today is so different, just like technology is so different. Back in the day, they came to the tent of meeting and they slaughtered animals. There was death every day, the shedding of blood and killing animals and bringing animals. And oh my goodness, you read it. How different today? Today, we can't even throw rice at a wedding inside. Is it different? It's different. A lot has changed. But you need to know that God delights in his people. And God says this in Isaiah 1, verse 11. Here's our verse for today, Isaiah 1:11. What to me is the multitude of your sacrifices, says the Lord. I've had enough of burnt offerings, of rams and the fat of well-fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. What does this verse mean to you? A lot of people look at the Old Testament and say God's a bloody God, a God that loves blood and sacrifice. No, God said to us, this is not his delight. It was a way for flawed people to have a relationship with him. And eventually God said, we're done with the sacrificial system. We need a once and final lamb to sacrifice. We need a once and perfect sacrifice. And that's why everything points us to Jesus. Let's look through these five things this morning. Five things that point us to the cross. There are five atonement sacrifices. We dealt with one of them last week, so I'll real quickly, we'll talk about it. I read that scripture last week, Leviticus 1, 1 through 9. Remember, God provided a way for them to offer a burnt sacrifice. That was either, if you had the money, a bull, or if you didn't have as much money, you could use a goat. If you didn't even have that, you could at least bring a bird. And no matter what social class you were from, you could offer a burnt sacrifice. What does this burnt sacrifice have to do? It provided a way to transfer fault, sin. Remember, the person had to place their hands on the sacrifice, basically transferring the guilt that they had onto this animal. I don't know, since last week, I don't know about you, but my worship has been different. Every time I'm singing worship and I lift my hands, all of a sudden I go, oh. Every time, even this morning, when I wanted to lift hands in worship. I thought, why do we do that? You know, some people do that like they're reaching up to Daddy. Abba. Abba. That's good. Some people do it as a way to express, but man, every time I'm lifting my hands recently in worship, I'm thinking, transfer of guilt. And it brings me to Jesus, and I'm thankful. When I lift my hands, I'm thinking, oh, I'm not. These hands are impure, imperfect hands. But you know what? God let me transfer my sin. And the burnt offering was to be completely consumed. The burnt offering, it was about Jesus. Matter of fact, I'm going to give you a word for each of these sacrifices today. The word for the burnt offering would be atonement. Everybody say atonement. It was a way to transfer my guilt away from me. But it was totally consumed. See, Jesus became our fault and shame, and he was completely consumed, sacrificed. The reason why God had them had this burnt, some people would say, this is too costly. PD, this is too costly. Or we might even use the word wasteful. Oh, let's not use the word wasteful. Isn't it interesting how God said this is what you need to do? You need to bring something that's costly, and you need to totally consume it. Wow. Why? His son was worthy, and his son was not worthless. His son was completely consumed on our behalf. We transferred our guilt to Jesus, and he was consumed. So this burnt offering was to point us to Jesus. Let's read that Hebrews 9:11-12. Hebrews 9:11-12. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, even though the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the bloods of goats and calves, but by the means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. Our guilt is transferred over to Jesus, and he's consumed. Oh, when you worship and lift holy hands, understand that we're hopeless and helpless unless it's transferred to the only one who can take our sins. The Bible says he became sin so that we might become his righteousness, the burnt offering. Galatians 3:24, would you turn there with me? Galatians 3:24. Get your Bibles or your new school typewriters out and be ready to follow me. We got lots of verses today. Galatians 3:24. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. The burnt offering was all about what Jesus was coming to do. The law was our schoolmaster. It was our guide. You know what? You need to know this morning that they didn't do these things in order to be saved. I need to point that out. God did not tell them to do these things to be saved. They had already been redeemed. God had already saved his people from slavery in Egypt. That has already taken place. So are all these sacrifices to save them? No, none of this routine can save any one of them. Our Bible makes it very clear, you're not saved through sacrifice, your sacrifice. You're always saved by grace through faith. They'd already been saved and rescued by grace out of Egypt. I wrote this saying down, it's important. Obedience flows from grace, it never buys it. You need to know this morning when we're talking about these five sacrifices people made, the atonement sacrifices, that is not how they got saved. They'd already been rescued. But rescued people live in obedience. And God said, if you're going to be near to me, if you're going to have a relationship with me, then you need to walk in a way. And God prescribed a way. And that way was to point them to Jesus. It didn't save them. Nobody was saved by the blood of bulls and goats. Nobody was. They were saved by grace through faith. Nobody gets to heaven without the shed blood of Jesus, and the shed blood of Jesus had not happened. So they were drawing near to God in a way that God said, this is going to be a way for you to understand that you're not a perfect people. But he said, come out among all the people and be a holy people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. So all of these sacrifices, I want you to make sure you understand, you cannot buy grace. You walk in grace because you've been redeemed. It's important for us to remember that. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed. blessed Savior, I surrender all. Remember that song? When they came to the tent of meeting, and they brought that animal to the gate, the priest came and met them there, and they put their hands on the priest, the worshiper. They put their hands, transferred their guilt to the animal, they sacrificed that animal, and it was all burnt up. Why? Jesus was consumed on our part. What do we do in return? God asks us to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. I surrender all. Sing with me. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Are we surrendering our all? The next offering that was there was called the grain offering. Turn with me to Leviticus 2. So many different offerings. While you're turning there, I need to set something straight too. We had great questions last week. I was talking to one of the members of the church, and they said, wait a second, this tent of meeting moved, but the Holy of Holies couldn't be entered. How did they move without getting killed? Well, read Numbers chapter 4 through 6. They had a process. It was awful. It was awful. They had to move. Whenever God's presence moved, they had to move the tent of meetings. So there's a process to not enter the Holy of Holies. You took the drape and you just let it fall down on top of the altar, the Ark of the Covenant. You couldn't touch it. Couldn't see it even. And they had to move that thing. It was drudgery. So Numbers 4 through 6 gives us the process how they moved this tent of meeting. Somebody also asked me, they said, last week you said that 24-7 there's sacrifices going on, but I thought it just did it once a year. Confusing two different things. These are five atonement sacrifices, individuals. Everybody say individual. Individuals came with. Once a year, the high priest made a sacrifice for the whole nation, making sure that they were purified. No sin remained. Once a year, that was done on their behalf. But even the priest had to come with these sacrifices. The priest couldn't go in that once a year until he made his own personal individual sacrifice for his sins. See, there was nobody perfect. That's why Jesus came as a greater high priest. He didn't need to make offerings for himself because he was pure. He was the perfect priest and the perfect sacrifice. He's the perfect temple. He's the perfect gate. He's the perfect bread of life. He's the perfect all things. That's why Jesus was the perfect sacrifice. So we're doing good. We're tracking through this, asking the right questions. But now we come to the grain offering, Leviticus 2, 1 through 3. When anyone brings a grain offering as an offering to the Lord, his offering shall be of fine flour. He shall pour oil on it and put frankincense on it and bring it to Aaron's son, the priest, and he shall take from it a handful of the fine flour and oil with all of the frankincense, and the priest shall burn it as a memorial portion on the altar, a food offering with a pleasant aroma to the Lord. But the rest of the grain offering shall be for Aaron and his sons. It is a most holy part of the Lord's food offering. Well, what's this grain offering? Here's the word, thanksgiving. Everybody say thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. Burnt offering was atonement. Grain offering is a thanksgiving offering. This was a way for them to come and thank God for providing for them. What did they bring? Fine flour. They had to take grain, they had to mash it, they had to work. It was expensive, they had to work at it. They made a fine flour. And they brought it with olive oil probably, because there's lots of olives there, lots of olive presses, and they would mix those two. They brought frankincense, but that didn't go in the bread. Listen how scripture says. They brought the oil and the flour, and then all the frankincense they brought to the priest, and the priest took some of the flour, some of the oil, and all of the frankincense and threw it on the altar. And it became a wonderful smell. It would be awful bread. It would taste awful with frankincense in it. So they burned up all the frankincense, a beautiful smell. It was an offering to the Lord, but just a memorial portion. What did we do with the rest? We made pancakes. We made bread. Well, why do we do that? Because the priest needs to eat. Guys, I love this portion where God says, you know what, those who serve me full time deserve some bread. You know that the priests were working 24-7. They were butchers. These were strong guys that had to handle all this, and they were working, so they couldn't be farmers. They couldn't be tent makers. They couldn't be plumbers. I don't know why I'm thinking plumbers. They couldn't be what's the iron stuff? Blacksmith. They couldn't do any of those. They worked full time for the Lord, and so the Lord provided for them in a loving way through people's thanksgiving. People just came to the Lord and said, I am so blessed. I have daily sustenance. Let's go to the temple. Let's take some fine flour and oil and give it to him. With some frankincense, they're going to throw just a handful on the altar. But the rest, Aaron and his sons get to eat. Well, I particularly like this passage because I serve the Lord full time. And you know what happens? This Sunday, we pass the plate around and a portion of that pays for me. I mean, I'm serious. My deodorant comes from that. My toothpaste comes from that. My food comes from that. And not all of the money you give. No. You look at our budget and we're below the average standard of what we're paying our staff. But we are taken care of out of that. The rest of the money goes to provide for things like we have a maintenance staff that cleans every week. We pay them. Pastor Shane and his family are blessed because he serves full time. He doesn't have another job. And so this principle continues on. God says, bring to me out of thanksgiving. And a portion of it goes to take care of those who serve me full time. Are we more important than you? Not at all. Are we high priest? Not at all. We're sheep like your sheep. We have a great shepherd over all of us. Yet God does call people. Shane and I, we get to be full time. And out of your thanksgiving to God, he takes care of his own. What a beautiful thing. Jesus' sacrificial death brought us life. Let's look at John. John chapter 12, verse 24. John 12, 24. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. What's he talking about? He's talking about grain. The actual grain that's planted as a seed, it dies. It has to die a death in order to grow into more grain. And Jesus was saying, I am the grain. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Unless I die and you partake of me, you don't have life. And so it's a thanksgiving offering. Are you thankful to God? Turn to John. John chapter 6, verse 51. John 6, verse 51. My wife always tells me, give them time to get there. But we don't got time, people. Come on. John 6, 51. I am the living bread, Jesus said. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. See, God set up this grain offering as a way for people to say, I am thankful for life. I am thankful that God sustains me. And this was just on their own. They just came when they wanted to. And they brought this offering. And God smelled the beautiful frankincense with the oil and the flour. And then the priest got to eat and have sustenance. What a great thing when God's people love God, share what they have in abundance with him, and through it others are blessed. It's a great thing. What a picture of family. What a picture of community. Are you offering up your best to the Lord? Please don't come and think you're giving to Shane or me. Please don't come and think you're giving to the maintenance and the cleaning. Please don't think you're coming and giving to the Awana Clubs or the Soul Fire or to Sunshine Park. Yes, your money does come and fund all those things, but you're giving to the Lord. Everybody say the Lord.
The Lord.
See, you might not ever think I'm worthy. You might never think he doesn't deserve it, and that's fine. You might think Shane doesn't deserve it. That's fine. You're not giving it to Shane. You're not giving it to me. You're not giving it to the Awana. You can't say as a believer, you know what? I'm going to give less because I don't like this thing. They say people vote with their pocketbooks, their checkbooks. Now they're online banking. You know what? That's wrong. It's just wrong. We don't give to specific things and to individual things. We give unto the Lord. And is God good?
Yes.
Maybe I should say it like this. God is good?
All the time.
And all the time.
Yes.
And that's why we give. No, it is our job. And guess what? Oh, man, not only do we have the responsibility of deciding what to give what to and making those decisions, we're accountable to it on our end. I don't see the Lord making you accountable to that. He makes you accountable to give unto the Lord a blessing, a thanksgiving. He requires us to be accountable for how we use it. Oh, friends, thanksgiving offering. We got to keep going. 1 Corinthians 9. 1 Corinthians 9, 13 and 14. 1 Corinthians 9, verses 13 and 14. Do Do you not know that those who are employed in the temple service get their food from the temple, and those who serve at the altar share in the sacrificial offerings? In the same way, the Lord commanded that those who proclaim the gospel should get their living by the gospel. Is it okay that we have full-time paid people? The Bible says yes. And if that's not what God called you to do, then that's not what God called you to do. Maybe God is calling some of you to do that. Well, then step out in faith and do that. But God made a way. A few thanksgiving. Everybody say thanksgiving. There's another offering. It's called the peace offering. Leviticus 3, 1 through 5. Leviticus 3, 1 through 5. What's the word for the peace offering? The word for the peace offering is relationship. Everybody say relationship. God provided a way to have a reconciled relationship with Him. Now, a lot of these, you're going to be confused and say, that sounds like the burnt offering. It sounds like a sin offering. It sounds like the once-a-year atonement offering. There's similarities, but there's five separate things individuals were doing. First, the burnt offering, atonement. Then the grain offering. That's about thanksgiving. And now comes the peace offering. That's all about relationship. And we know that Jesus destroyed the dividing wall of hostility. Turn to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2. 13 through 16. Oh, see, the Holy of Holies had a veil, a thick curtain, up to 4 or 6 inches thick between the Holy of Holies and the common place, the holy place, and then the courtyard. There was a dividing wall. Only the high priest could enter. There was a dividing wall. The Bible makes it clear that Jesus did something for us on our behalf. Ephesians 2, 13 through 16. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For He Himself is our peace. Everybody say peace.
Peace.
Who has made us both one and has broken down in His flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in the ordinances, that He might create in Himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace. Might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. Oh, I love this. This offering, they came, and it's an animal offering, and it could be of either gender. The Bible doesn't always say to bring a male. This is an offering. It could be a male or a female. They brought this offering, and all the fat was burned. They took all the fat portions. Oh, Will. Will won again yesterday at our bacon men's thing. And Will brings some good food, but oh, it's the best of the fat. We don't offer the fat to the Lord on the bacon day. We eat it ourselves. And He had venison backstrap wrapped in bacon, and it was marvelous. Marvelous. But this offering was a relationship offering, and they brought the fat portions, and the priest would burn up the fat portions, and then the rest was for the worshiper. What was this all about? Oh, I love this. They got to eat. The priest got to eat. They got to eat. God got His portion from the back, the best parts. Well, what is this all about? Well, God wants us to have a relationship with Him and with others. Peace with God, peace with others. It's a fellowship meal. A peace offering was wonderful because it was a way of coming to the temple and saying, I just want to be right with God. I want to have a relationship with the holy God. And God said, there's a way. I've made a way for you. It's a temporary way. Jesus is going to come and tear down the veil, and it's going to be a one-on-one relationship. But for now, you're going to come, and you can be right with God. But then you know what you did? You invited people. You invited people. On the day you're going to make a peace offering, you probably brought your neighbors because there's a lot to eat. And you got to make a sacrifice to God, but then you ate together. It's a peace offering. It's about relationship. How many of you got plans for lunch today? Oh, liars, all y'all. Now tell the pastor when you're not paying attention. How many of y'all have plans for lunch today? Thank you. I know you're going to eat. You're going to eat. How many of you are going out for lunch with somebody here at the church? How many going out to lunch somewhere at the church? Josh raised his hand. He don't even know. He looked at his mom. We always do, right? Josh raised his hand. His mom's not today. We make plans. I know Michael Tinsman, he's out there in security. He's been telling us for the last couple of days, we're going to get together. We want the old small group to get together. Let's eat lunch. And we're trying to get us together. You know what? I love that. Can I, as a pastor, throw something out? Because I don't want you to think I'm all crazy about this fast next week. We're going to fast next week for 24 hours. But until then, eat together. Go eating together. Coach Clint said yesterday is one way you know how friends are friends. They eat together. It's true. You know what I want? I want to throw out another challenge. I want us to fast next week. But between now and then, I challenge you to not fast with somebody. Go eat together. Find somebody and go out to lunch together. Eat together. Because it's a good thing. It's a fellowship thing. It's a relationship thing. I didn't get it done, Shane. I'm sorry. Shane said, you should show pictures from yesterday. You should have seen the spread with all the bacon and meats. And then my wife came home with pictures. There was fruits. Salads. I said, oh my goodness, the contrast was unbelievable. Now they did have a chocolate fountain, which made me think, next baby to buy there, chocolate fountain. Oh, man. But here's the thing, people are like, well, what's wrong with y'all having food in church? There's a reason. We fellowship, we eat together. Your pastor's chubby. And he's chubby because y'all are coming saying, let's do lunch, let's do dinner, let's do breakfast all week long. I'm telling you, I said yesterday, Jeff, they're going to have to raise my professional expense because I'm eating all the time with people. And I realized, it's okay, God, it's a good thing. When we share a meal, we're sharing from ourselves. And God said, this is a good thing. God said, it's a good thing. Bring an offering. I want to smell the offering. The priests need to eat some meat. They got some good bread, but now they need some meat. And you need to eat together too. Oh, it's good to eat together. Can I challenge you? We used to have a thing called Dinners for Six. I used to like that. Dinners for Six. One couple invited two other couples and just they made it a habit. Can I challenge you as a church? Do your own Dinners for Six this month sometime. You and your husband or wife, or if you're single, it doesn't matter. Go out of your way to invite two other couples or two other groups of people and say, let's eat together. Let's eat. Pastor Bob, you're dying. Let's do it. Whatever. Just, it's relationship. Everybody say relationship.
Relationship.
I have time for one more. Let's not. I'm gonna put the pause on. Instead of hurrying through this, we're trying to be better at our timing here as well. We're heading to two services come this fall. We're going to start in September with two services, one at 9, one at 11. We're practicing this Easter, by the way. Easter is going to be 9 and 11. But in order for us to do that, I need to watch my time. And so we've got time next week. I want to pick this up because I don't want to rush. These five individual offerings, people come and they offer to the Lord, are so important. But they show us something about us, and they show us something about Jesus. Are you coming to the Lord in atonement? Placing your sins upon Jesus, the propitiation, the covering of our sins, the burnt offering. Are you coming to the Lord with thanksgiving and saying, God, thank you for providing. I am just so well blessed. Thank you for the food and sustenance and roof over our heads. And are you coming to the Lord with thanksgiving? Are you coming to the Lord with a peace offering and realizing that Jesus made a way? We were far off. Did you hear that verse? We were far off. We were enemies of God. I always bust out in this song. Now, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Those who once were far away now have been drawn near. And he made a peace offering with him, an atonement, a thanksgiving, a peace offering. And then are you sharing with one another in fellowship relationship? Those things aren't just old school. See, the Old Testament was just a shadow of things to come. So where is church today? We're his people. He wants still to have a relationship with them. Does it look like it did? Not at all. Not at all. There are some things that are still the same, though, aren't there? The shift key, the return key. Some things are the same. Sin happens and the correction has to happen. Are we living our lives as a sweet-smelling savor to the Lord? Over and over again, God says, I'll take the offerings of sweet smelling. But he did say in Isaiah, remember the beginning? He's tired of the blood bulls and goats. He doesn't desire sacrifice. He desires relationship. Are we walking in relationship today? The only way you can have that is through Jesus Christ. Next week we'll come back and we'll talk about the sin offering, then the guilt offering, and then I want to talk to you about the Day of Atonement, the one where the priest himself does sacrifice for the whole nation. I want to end our section here in God the Lawgiver with those things. Let's pray. Father God, I pray this morning that you would bless as our worship team comes to the stage to sing us out and let us worship you. God, I pray as we come and offer our worship, as we lift our hands, we would understand the blood of Jesus. We would place upon him our guilt and be thankful that our God delights in us, even though we're sinners. Even though we're sinners, Christ died for us because he loves us. He desires relationship with us. All of this is delight, not drudgery. So God, help us to love your word. Help us to love you. Help us to love others, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
We sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
happening still yet today, so I'll remind you. Parents, SoFire students, we need a parent from every family to come tonight. We've got some games, or they're going to be participating a little bit too. So parents, come and hear an update on SoFire ministry and some plans coming. Make sure you're here for that. Students and parents together tonight, 6 o'clock. Also, here's that letter. My wife wanted me to make sure I told you that the church did not type this letter because there's a bunch of typos. It was an individual who cared and wants to, so when you see this, it's out there on the thing. You can be a part of that to help the person who's getting involved in that House of Providence support. And then don't forget, if you're interested in helping us with that stuff sale, meet in the library right now with Marie, okay? Hey, go in peace. God bless.